Welcome to this edition of Adobe Think Tank. I am Daya Nadamuni with Adobe's corporate strategy team, and with me here today is Susan Etlinger, industry analyst with the Altimeter Group. Welcome, Susan.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here.
It's great to be here in this beautiful little space.
Oh, and I'm so excited to be talking to you about, you know, what AI means for digital strategy for the customer experience.
Yeah.
So would you tell us a little more about how you're thinking about it?
Sure. So, you know, I come to this from a layperson's perspective, right? I'm not an engineer. I have a background in the humanities, and I've been doing research into data and sort of how businesses use data. And now increasingly algorithms and artificial intelligence technologies for the past few years. And what strikes me is that, you know, now that we live in a world where we have in many cases sort of algorithms, machine learning algorithms that sit between an individual and an organization, it really changes the experience. And so in some cases we've gotten used to it, it's not that big a deal. Like you think about search, or you think about a recommendation engine, you know, if you buy something on Amazon, you're used to that. Even predictive text in our messaging, tools, like we're kind of used to that and we laugh about it, but we sort of know it's there, we sort of don't really care so much. But now that we have tools like Alexa, you know, voice agents, chatbots, obviously autonomous vehicles coming, there's this real difference in the way that we interact with technology and in many ways interact with products and services from the way that we used to do it. And so, you know, one of the things I started to think about, especially as regards to, you know, voice and anything that kind of has to do with language, is that now we're dealing with an entity that may or may not be human. And we don't really have ways of knowing that sometimes. And so that there's a need to be transparent. Or we're looking at something that looks kind of a little like that vase on the table, and we're talking to it, but we don't know what it knows. We don't know how much it can help us. We don't know what it's able to do. We don't know what it knows about us. And so that really kind of creates a few different things. One is an opportunity to think about design differently, to think about, like, how do you design for a space in which people don't know what they can ask? It also creates an opportunity to think about, like, how transparent should we be? You don't want to over-explain and stop the experience and kind of, like, you know, clutter it up with stuff. And at the same time, you don't want to do something where you surprise somebody in an unpleasant way. And so then it gets into questions of kind of ethics, right? And ethics are simply just accepted norms of behavior. Or you could say of moral behavior, but let's just say in a business context, accepted norms of behavior. We don't really have accepted norms of behavior in an AI world. And so we have to ask the question, should it have a gender? Should we know that it's a robot? Should it be able to make decisions on our behalf that are different from the kinds of decisions that were made in the past? So that's kind of where this all started to boil up for me.
Well, that's super interesting, and you're absolutely right. I mean, we think of it as Alexa or Siri, so we've personified these intelligences that we don't stop to think about what's actually behind it. So, and you bring up a very good point about ethics and bias. I mean, there are a lot of concerns around, you know, how do we not only design the best possible experience, but do it in a way that's ethically right.
Yeah, and so this comes out in an interesting way. So I have a little bit of an addiction to MIT Technology Review, and I read, you know, pretty much everything I can get my hands on that comes out. And, you know, there have been these situations that are very well known among sort of data scientists and machine learning technologists, but not necessarily in the rest of the world, about things like, you know, the data set that's used to train translation algorithms and search algorithms. It has biases in it. And it's not that the algorithm itself has a bias. It's that it absorbs all the biases that occur in the culture that it's been trained on. So if, for example, we live in a world in which more women are nurses than men are nurses, if you're a mathematical model, a probabilistic model, you will then infer that it's more likely for a nurse to be female. And you could actually misgender somebody that way.
Right.
If you are training a voice agent on the kind of voice, for example, that I have, or in England, let's say, you know, BBC English, it's less likely to understand accents that diverge from that. Will it understand someone from Glasgow? Will it understand an African-American, you know, somebody who speaks African-American vernacular English? Will it understand somebody from South Asia, you know, who's learned English maybe as a second language or speaks English but not as often as they speak their first language? So there are all sorts of different ways in which we have to be really careful not to inadvertently disenfranchise people because of the fact that we think of math as being inherently neutral.
No, and that's very true, because the unconscious biases can just slip in and you don't know until the output sort of gives you the wrong results or something like that.
That's right, that's right. And there have been stories, there's stories about, you know, gender bias, there's stories about race bias, both in computer vision and in voice agents. And, you know, when you think about it, you know, one of the challenges here is, like, you know, we've seen this with Facebook and the Cambridge Analytics stuff, where, for example, if you are not receiving an ad because an algorithm has made an inference that you're not the right audience segment, right target for that ad, but that ad is for maybe a low-interest credit card that would actually be an economic boon to you, like, that's not fair if the person sitting next to you then got that ad. And so we have to think about issues of fairness. And that doesn't necessarily mean we're going to kind of, you know, prevent every bad outcome from happening. But what I'm arguing for is we have to be realistic about what we live in, and we have to be very intentional about the world that we want to create in a digital space.
Absolutely, absolutely. So we've talked a little bit about the customer experience. I'm also curious to hear your thoughts on how AI enhances our productivity workflows, our business workflows.
Yeah, I mean, there's some really interesting stories about this. So, you know, one of the great things about AI and about math is that, and about computers and processing, is that they can just take in a ton more data than we can as humans. You know, even the math savants, you know, in the world, and they can and process it. And so sometimes it can see patterns that we can't see. Those patterns could be patterns about, like, the kind of actions that precede a conversion event, you know, in a commerce process. Or it could be, you know, a way to shorten an account opening in a financial services company, you know, from 15 days to 2 days. Or it could be a way to find fraud or money laundering, or it could be a way to find a tumor, you know, 10 years before it becomes a tumor. And so, like, there's just a tremendous, you know, yes, there are challenges, and yes, there are risks, but there's a tremendous, I think, social and business and economic value to these technologies. And it's sort of that old Spider-Man adage, like, what, you know, with great power comes great responsibility. But we shouldn't also forget that there's, like, the great power and potential in these technologies, too.
So if I had to ask you, you know, the top two or three things you'd advise brands and enterprises to keep in mind as they're thinking about leveraging AI for their digital strategies, what would those be?
So I would say that artificial intelligence, and, you know, I'm using the term sort of loosely, because right, if anybody was listening to yesterday's live stream, they probably know that it's not the easiest term to define.
True, true.
Even if you get a bunch of experts, especially if you get a bunch of experts in a room. But, you know, what I would say is that it really, this is a massive shift. And, you know, if we're lucky in our lifetime, we get to live through one massive shift. I think this is, at least for me, kind of two, right? There's the internet, which dramatically changed the relationship between companies and people, because now it gave people a voice. And then now there's this sort of intelligence shift. You could call it the fourth industrial revolution. You could call it whatever you like. But which now enables organizations to learn from the data that they have, the experiences that they have at scale, right? You have individual learning, but now we have the ability to learn at scale. So I think the first thing is, remember, this is a massive shift. It does require culture change. And while it's perfectly good to start with proof of concepts and build from there, I think it's important to have that long-term perspective in the back of your mind. That's the first thing. The second thing is, we really are moving from a rules-based world to a more probabilistic world. And that also changes the way we set KPIs and measurements and the way that we set values. And so precision and accuracy, which are the thing, you know, sort of the Six Sigma, you know, things that most companies really want, like, that's almost not possible in an algorithmic world.
Absolutely. There's a lot more room for
So change. This is a big, like, culture shift, I think, for and mind shift for people. And then the third thing I would say is never forget that you have to just get started and be pragmatic, sure. Right? Not every company has the resources of a Facebook or an Amazon or a Google or a Baidu, for that matter. But you can get started with a proof of concept, with a project that is focused on something that really matters to you. You know, don't do something cool and vanity unless you want to win a con lion, you know, that's perfectly good. But if you really want to move the needle, start with trying to optimize a part of your business that isn't working as well.
Oh, that's great. Well, we're at time. So thank you everyone for tuning in to this live stream of the Adobe Think Tank. So follow us on Twitter and tune in again for other episodes. Adobe, hashtag Adobe TT. Thank you, Susan.